Dr. Abraham is a professor at the University of St. Thomas, where he researches on renewable energy and climate change. He studies ocean warming and scientists in China and Australia. He also installs small grid energy systems in Africa. He is married, lives in Minneapolis, and has three children. So he's a remarkable teacher. His students absolutely love him. And who John is for me is always said yes. He's got three little girls at home. He said, how far away is Red Wing? I said, about an hour. He was here an hour early to come and meet people. John does this work because he loves his science, he loves to communicate, and he knows that he doesn't want his three daughters coming to him and saying, Dad, you knew about this thing back in 2015. Why didn't you do something about it? And he is doing it. Tomorrow he'll be at another CCL event in Prior Lake. He speaks constantly, he's on NPR, he blogs for The Guardian, he's an IPCC reviewer, just a remarkable presenter, and he's already let me know that his presentation is available for all of you, so that this is your training session. So listen carefully and take this information into your heart, because we need to get it out to the world. It's my honor to introduce Dr. John Abraham.
Musicians and an elected official. But then, so I was feeling depressed, but then you said all those nice things about me, Paul. So I'm recovering a little bit. In my day job, I do climate research. I work with scientists from around the world, and if you have trouble hearing me, just raise your hand and let me know. I work with scientists around the world measuring what's happening to our climate. In particular, I measure ocean warming, and I measure something called paleoclimate, which is what climate was like in the past. I love the science, but the reason why I'm here today is because not only is it an interesting scientific topic, but it has such impact to us in our lives and in the lives of future generations. What is remarkable, though, is how fast things can change. So I'm going to give you a climate change 101 type talk, and this talk over the past few years has been depressing, really depressing to me, but when you think about what has happened both in the United States and internationally, there's real reason for hope. There's real reason to believe and to know that this is a problem that we can solve. So I'm going to go through this talk, and I think that there is time for questions afterwards. So if you've got some questions, maybe you could hold them till afterwards. And then I've got the Twitter. I don't know. I don't Twitter, but a hashtag something. So people, if you're doing this, I should be looking at that crowd, right? The Twitter generation. All right. So science comes out all the time. Every day we get new science studies that come out that I'm ravenously reading. But most of us are tuned into this science that comes out every 5 or 6 years through what's called the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. And the highlights of their 2013 report are this. Warming is unequivocal. The last few decades have warmed. Extreme weather events. Greenland and Antarctica losing ice, decreased snow cover, etc., etc. So those things are observed. Some of them are observed quite clearly. Some are things that have only been observed recently. But the question is, what do we do about it? And what are the implications if we take action compared to if we don't take action? So this is sort of a cost-benefit analysis that we're going to go through. before I get into the science, I want to give a little personal story. So I'm going to cover the things that were on the prior slide, but this image, this photograph, is really important for me. I got this photograph from the photographer around 2007 when I started giving talks in the community about climate change. And back then it spoke to me about social justice. And it spoke to me about who is going to suffer disproportionately from a problem which has been largely made by the developed world. And the color of this child's skin and the continent which is facing the photographer speak volumes. More recently, the left middle finger of that child has taken on a particularly profound meaning because that left middle finger ends on the country of Uganda. And that's a country that I've traveled to numerous times to put in renewable energy systems for people who have no electricity. But even more importantly, I have had the good fortune to welcome into my family my adopted daughter from Uganda. And so this isn't an abstract thing to me. I mean, I'm a scientist and I'm trained to be completely objective about the science. And when I present the science, I try to be objective about it, but it also has personal meaning to me. So you've often heard the phrase, 97% of scientists agree. Sort of like 97% of doctors agree that eating fruits and vegetables is good for you. 97% of scientists agree that humans are causing climate change. Why are we so convinced? Well, it's not just that the climate's changing. It's that it's changing in the right way. It has what's called the fingerprints of humans. And here are some of the fingerprints, some of the things that we're observing. But let me give you a simple example. Some people say, John, it's the sun that's getting hotter. It's not heat-trapping gases. Well, that's a testable idea. And in fact, if the sun were the cause of warming, we would expect days to warm more than nights. Days are when the sun is shining. We're observing the opposite. We're observing nights to warm more than days. If it were the sun, we would expect the entire atmosphere to warm because the sunlight passes through the entire atmosphere. That's not what we're observing. We're observing the heat being held down, so the upper part of the atmosphere is getting colder. So it's not just that the Earth is warming, which is unequivocal. It's that it's warming in the right way for human-emitted heat-trapping gases. We call it fingerprints. It has the fingerprints of humans. So what is this greenhouse effect? Well, sunlight travels to the Earth and it passes through the atmosphere. And the atmosphere is transparent to sunlight, which is why we can see things during the day. The Earth sends out its own energy. It's called infrared. It's like sunlight, but it's not visible. Our atmosphere is like a one-way window. It can trap the infrared energy and send it back to Earth. And that, in a nutshell, is the greenhouse effect. And we should note that even if humans weren't here, we would have a greenhouse effect. And we're lucky we have a greenhouse effect, because if we had no greenhouse effect, the Earth would be uninhabitably cold. It would be below zero. It would be about 0 degrees. So the question isn't, do we have a greenhouse effect or not? There is a natural greenhouse effect. The real question is, what happens if we make the natural greenhouse more potent? It's like if you are comfortable in bed with 3 blankets on, what happens if you add a fourth and a fifth? So is this greenhouse effect increasing? The answer is clearly yes. The most important human-emitted greenhouse gas, and I'm so sorry for the guy with the camera because I tend to walk around and I should be more considerate. The most important human-emitted greenhouse gas is carbon dioxide. It's not the only one we emit, but it's the most important. The graph that you're looking at on the screen is one of the most famous. Am I still live?
Yes.
Okay. one of the most famous graphs in all of science. It's called the Keeling curve.
Can't hear you.
Still on.
Okay.
All right, this is live?
Yeah.
Yes.
My wife says, only drop your microphone if it's going poorly, so I hope. The graph you're looking at on the screen, my wife also says every graph that you put on the screen cuts half of the audience's attention. So that's not true down in Redwood. But this is one of the most famous graphs in all science. It's called the Keeling curve, named after Charles David Keeling. Started in 1957, he started measuring carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. And now that he's passed on, his son continues the measurements. And this graph starts, as I said, in 1957, and it extends to today, and I could add the last few years, but we're at a level of 400 now. 400 what? 400 parts per million. What that means is, for every million molecules in the atmosphere you take out, 400 of them are carbon dioxide. What's important is, where did we start? Before the Industrial Revolution, we were at about 280. So we've had an increase of about 40% since the onset of the Industrial Revolution. And this is clear. I mean, this is measurements taken painstakingly at multiple locations around the world. It's not just carbon dioxide. Methane and nitrous oxide are also two important greenhouse. On the right is the year 2000, on the left is the year zero. And you can see that around 1700 or 1800, all three of those greenhouse gases begin to rise quickly. So where is this stuff from? Where is it coming from? Well, electricity is one of our biggest sources. In the US, coal makes about 42% of our electricity, about a third of all of our emissions. And if you go, at the end of the month, if you look at your energy bill, each kilowatt hour, which is how electricity is measured, is equivalent to 2 pounds of CO2 or 18 cubic feet of space filled with CO2. Transportation is another source. Each gallon of gas that we burn releases about 20 pounds of CO2. Now that's staggering because the weight of the gas is only about 7 pounds. The CO2 coming out of your tailpipe is heavier than the liquid gas you put in your car. Is anyone here a chemist? Okay, we're balancing, we're adding two O's to a C, so this isn't black magic, this is chemistry. 173 cubic feet of space per gallon of gas. Now, we're contributing to the greenhouse effect right now. I drove down, I have a very efficient car, but I drove down here today, so I'm contributing to it. Now, as we think about what to do about this problem, I'm not saying that we shut everything down and live in the Stone Ages, but we at least need to know what the sources are if we're going to make smart decisions as we move forward, and knowing the biggest sources is very important. So, is the Earth really warming? Well, this is a graph from NASA of all the temperatures back to 1880. Each black dot is a year, and you'll see that some years are hot, some years are cold, but what we want to look at is the trend. So here are the 10 hottest years on record. Back to 1880, this is your top 10. Oh, I guess I'm going to give you 11. Where's 2015? We're going to blow the hottest year out of the water. So last year was the hottest year ever. 2015 is guaranteed to break that record. Sometimes people will say, oh, global warming stopped 5 years ago or 10 years ago. And what they're usually doing is they're trying to find a hot year, let's say 1998, and then a cold year, and then they say, look, it hasn't gotten warmer in 10 years. But what scientists do is, we're not so concerned about any one year. Just because 2015 is going to be the hottest year on record, that doesn't prove global warming. What we want to do is look at the trends, the long-term trends. And the trends are clearly upwards.
We can go back further in time, and this is a graph that goes back 400,000 years, and it shows two things. It shows greenhouse gases and temperatures. I'll explain how we got temperatures later. But the important thing from this graph is greenhouse gases and temperature go together. When one goes up, the other goes up. When one goes down, the other goes down. We call them handcuffed to each other. When one moves, the other moves. So, John, how do we know what happened 400,000 years ago? We didn't have thermometers and NASA. Well, we do have signals from nature. And we call those proxies. Now, before we get to the slide, let me ask this. Does anyone here camp? Okay. Wow. I should have known. So let's say you go up camping. My oldest daughter, my wife, just got back from a camping trip today. And let's say that you went on that camping trip with them, and for some reason you brought a shovel. And when everyone else was roasting marshmallows and campfire songs, you were digging. And let's say it's northern Minnesota and you dig down into the dirt and you discover palm fronds and crocodile fossils. What would you conclude about the past climate of Minnesota? Hunter, you are my new paleoclimate scientist colleague. Exactly, it's hotter. We use signals from nature to tell us what the climate was like. They're not as good as thermometers, but they're pretty darn good. One of the most famous, probably the most famous proxy is ice cores. There's a photograph of a scientist digging in an ice core, and they can actually go down 2 miles into an ice sheet, pull out this ice core, and I've got a photograph of 1 meter long segment, and you can see bands. Those are like tree rings or annual rings, and you can actually count back in time. And you can melt the ice, and when you melt the ice, you release the atmosphere that was trapped when the snow fell. And the type of ice that forms tells you what the temperature was. So you have time, temperature, and greenhouse gas levels, and that's how you get that kind of curve. So I want to quit looking backwards. I want to look forward now. This is the temperature over the last 1,000 years. That's what we're concerned about. That is going backwards. That's what's coming by 2100. I mean, it is incredible what we expect. And we are already seeing this. This is the US temperature records from 2012. That was a hot year. Every state that was red had their hottest year on record. Every state that was orange was just very hot. And I actually had people tell me it wasn't too hot because Washington was just a little bit above normal. Why do we care about this? Because that was our drought that year. That drought cost us $35 million. This stuff has societal and economic consequences. At the end of that drought, or in early 2013, this is what happened. And this is anything blue or purple is very wet, and anything brown or black was very dry. We went into a seesaw where it started to flood in some parts of our country, but then the West Coast became dry. And this is our drought monitor just this July. It's actually worse than this now. This is out in California. The drought in California is costing us billions of dollars right now. And in fact, this is the trend of billion-dollar disasters by year. And it says at the top, unadjusted for inflation, but it is actually adjusted for inflation. It's a mislabel. These expensive events are becoming more frequent. Yeah. You've always got to add a daily show. One of the things that we deal with in climate change is people confusing weather with climate. You can't look out your window and tell someone what climate is like. You have to look over long-term trends and over large space regions to know what the climate's doing. So just as a cold day doesn't disprove global warming, a hot day doesn't prove it. Right now, we've got really, really warm temperatures on the east side of the US. I think they're breaking all-time records, so some people are nodding their heads, you've heard this. That doesn't prove global warming. What we want to do is look at long-term trends, and we want to see something emerge, and we are seeing clear indications. And one of the things that we're seeing is in the Arctic. This is a image, the white part, it's hard to see against the background, but the white is the ice that existed in 1980. You can't even see the thing on the right, though. Can you guys see that? Oh, that's terrible. So I don't, that is a picture of the US minus Arizona. So you're gonna have to use your imagination. People have a good imagination, that's great. So this is how much ice we lost through 2005 with its equivalent US states, US regions. That's how much we lost in 2007, and then that was 2013. So we've lost half of our country in Arctic ice. And when you look at it like that, it puts things in perspective. I'm gonna skip this. This image looks like a lake, but it's actually a melt pond on top of Greenland's ice sheet.
Wow.
Yeah, it's amazing. I mean, that is awe-inspiring, but something else inspiring as well. I'm gonna go to the southern hemisphere, Antarctica. Here's a photograph, an image of the Antarctica with a call out of the Larsen B ice shelf. And here are a series of satellite images. January 31st, February 23rd, March 5th, and March 7th. An area the size of Rhode Island that had been around for well over 10,000 years collapsed into the ocean in a month and a half. If you've seen the movie The Day After, is it The Day After Tomorrow?
Yes.
Now there's a lot of fictitious things in there and non-physical things, but movie was motivated in large part by this collapse, which happened very, very abruptly. More recently, the Wilkins Ice Shelf collapsed with an outline showing the last part of that ice shelf. And we see this on land-based glaciers. So this is a photograph of McCarty Glacier in 1909, and then 2004, the camera was in the same spot, so you can see what has happened to the glacier. Same thing for the Muir and Riggs glaciers. And this is a photograph of some alpine glaciers. Before is on the left, currently is on the right. And then Portage Glacier, 1914 on the left, 2004 on the right. Why do we care? I mean, so people who like to hike glaciers will have fewer places to hike. Why do we care about this stuff, John? Well, if you live in Asia, or if you live near the sea, especially Bangladesh, you care. Bangladesh has 20 million people that live within a meter of sea level rise. That's what we expect by 2100. Around the world, 150 million people live within a meter of sea level rise. How do you handle climate refugees? What do you do if you're India? I mean, we in the US had trouble handling refugees from New Orleans. We're the richest country in the world. What do you do if you're India? The US military is quite logical on climate change. They view climate change as one of the biggest, if not the biggest, long-term security threat. So people who deal with the risk all the time are looking at this. What about the southern US? That's 1 meter of sea level rise. That's 3. And that is 6. Could oceans rise that much? Well, if Greenland melted, we would get 23 feet just through Greenland. If the western part of Antarctica melted, which is the smaller but unstable part, we would get 17 feet. And if all of Antarctica melted, which we don't expect to happen, we would have 270 feet. So there's a lot of potential sea level rise. And then this is the slide where I just usually get really depressed. I see some students are putting their heads down, what do we do? I usually get really depressed because these are some of the other bad things that we expect. Lower crop yields, ocean acidification is my biggest concern. We're actually, the ocean is actually absorbing carbon dioxide, and we've changed the pH of the ocean. Just like if you take a soda can and you shake it and then you open it, it fizzes because carbon dioxide is coming out of the liquid. It's a carbonated beverage. The same thing's true with the ocean. And the reason why we care about this is if you are a shell-forming creature, it is hard to form a shell in an acidic ocean. So this affects basic food chain stuff. The general rule of thumb about water is the areas that are currently wet will become wetter, the areas that are currently dry will become drier. Increase of extreme events, hurricanes, the jury's still out. The prevailing view is they'll be fewer but more powerful. Invasive species, migration of flora, and extinctions, and so forth. So what do we do? Well, the way forward is not a silver bullet. If this is the graph, I think this is the last graph, by the way. If this is the graph showing where our emissions are gonna be by 2050, what we need is silver buckshot. A bunch of things that added together make an impact. Things done at community levels, state levels, national levels, and international levels. Things done in your daily lives, but also things done as a community. These things really matter. Using energy more wisely, going further on a gallon of gas, planting trees, all of this stuff matters. What can you do? Today, Obama killed the Keystone Pipeline. Now, it's not technically dead because the next president could reverse it, but it's temporarily dead for sure. Every politician who supports that move should hear from us. Local politicians, I heard this, Adam, that if a politician gets one or two letters or phone calls about something, it's a bunch of cranks, but if they get five, it's a groundswell. And it's really true. So take time, write or call your state or federal elected officials and tell them you support using energy more wisely and more renewable energy. Change is possible. I love this photo on the left. So rusty oil well in the foreground and beautiful wind turbines in the background. The guy on the right is making algae-based biofuels. Algae biofuels, they pull CO2 out of the air. So they clean our air so that when you burn the biofuels, you're just creating a cycle. You're not adding CO2, there's no net addition to CO2. So I used to have this, I thought, pretty nice time slide, and I just changed it. So I made this one up. But I've got these daughters at home, as Paul mentioned. And they, you know, they want their dad home. And of course, I want to go out and meet great people like you who are making the world a better place. And I tell them, when they say, Dad, why do you need to drive to Red Wing? I tell them why, and they know why. And this is Lilith on the left and Olivia on the right. Lilith wants to be a paleontologist, that's Lily. And Olivia wants to be a large animal vet. And I'm fortunate that I get to travel to places and try to make people's lives better in places where they don't have a lot of energy. This is my newest daughter, Avery. The first picture you saw was her in her orphanage, and this is her as a true Minnesotan. This is us on a safari with lions in the background. And there's human society and there's natural habitat, which are both at stake here. And as Paul said, my daughters are going to ask me one of two questions. They're going to say, Dad, you knew. You knew. What did you do about it? Or they're going to say, how did your generation find the uncommon courage to take action to hand us a better world? I desperately want my daughters to ask me that second question. And far from being depressed, I have a renewed sense of hope. If you think of what has happened over the last 4 years, we have major international agreements, in particular with China. We have increased energy efficiency. We have a clean power plan with regulations on new and existing coal plants. We have the killing of the Keystone Pipeline, which was designed to help extract the dirtiest of all dirty fuels. I mean, you can't get dirtier than tar sands. If you can't say no to the Keystone, what can you say no to? Now that Keystone is now buried in the ground. The U.S. emissions are going down. Our emissions are lower now than they were in prior years. And people now realize, another thing that really excites me is the economics. Wind and solar can compete with coal on dollars. How much does it cost to bring electricity to your household or your company? Things are aligning. And we have seen with smartphones and with the internet and different technologies, things can change very rapidly. And I'm hoping that we stay in our leadership position. Paul, I think that's the first time I've ever said the Americans were in a leadership position. That feels good. And so thank you for listening. There's one more slide. What are the takeaway messages? There's four of them. The first takeaway message is, scientists know. We've actually known about the greenhouse gas effect for over 150 years. We knew it in the 1800s. We can solve this problem today with today's technology. We don't need some fairy dust or cold fusion. In the future, we can solve it right now. If we're smart, we can solve the environmental problem while we create jobs, diversify our energy supply, and improve national security. There's all these other benefits. And then finally, don't let anyone tell you that doing something is too expensive. I say doing nothing is too expensive. Superstorm Sandy was an $88 billion disaster. The drought in 2012, $35 billion. The year before that, there was a drought in Texas, $6 billion. This year, there's the terrible California drought. These things cost us dearly. And if we do nothing, we're going to incur more and more costs as we move forward. So if we're smart, we can reduce the cost to ourselves and our future generations. And that, as I promised, was my last slide. So I want to take this opportunity and thank you for letting me come talk. I'll be happy to answer questions, and I don't, Paul, you'll have to be the MC in control how long we do this, but yeah, we've got
at least 15 minutes.
Great. Well, it's a low battery. Here, I'll let you. But we've got a great, got a microphone. So we've got some questions.
Thanks, Jeff Coles of Vermont Media. I couldn't help but notice on the chart the steadily increasing carbon content. I also noticed in the mid-70s. There was a very noticeable drop in the CO2 increase. That right about the time we went to unleaded gas in the fuels.
So you're talking around 1975 or 1970?
75, yeah.
So the first question was, what's this cycle? And I should have explained this in more depth, but the red is the measurements, and the measurements go up and down each year like a sawtooth. Now, why do they go up and down each year? There's something about our planet. Most of the land is in the northern hemisphere. Most of the southern hemisphere is ocean. So what that means is, during the spring, our spring and summer, most of the world's plants grow. And then in our fall and winter, those plants drop their leaves, and the leaves then decompose, right? So in the spring, the plants are growing and they're sucking carbon dioxide out of the air. In the fall, those plants release their carbon dioxide. So there's an annual cycle. So there's up and down each year. And the key thing is, how is that changing from one year to the next? And that's this underlaid black curve. That's the average. So that explains the cycle. Your question about this drop in 1965 or 1970 could be related to switches of gasoline. I don't actually know the answer. So you've given me some homework. Why is that changed? I don't know.
Okay, Steve Scherzer from Iowa. You talked about the acidification of the oceans. Can you tell us more about the ramifications of that and how quickly you think that would become very serious?
I don't know the answer. And part of it is because it depends on what kind of creature you are. Creatures at the base of the food chain that create calcium carbonate shells are the ones most at risk. And they will feel the effects sooner than other animals. Some animals actually will grow faster with carbon dioxide, but there aren't many of them. Lobsters are one. But the food at the base of the food chain is what we're most concerned about. The other reason why this problem is so difficult to solve, to answer, your question is difficult to answer, is there's a confounding factor of temperature. So you've heard about bleaching corals. Has anyone heard about bleaching corals? So bleaching corals are happening because those animals are used to a very small temperature window. And when you get too hot, you can kill the corals just through temperature. So it's really a combination of things that are threats. Fortunately, the world's expert in ocean acidification is Dr. Richard Feely, who works at NOAA, but he's from St. Paul. And if you look him up, F-E-E-L-Y, F-E-E-L-Y, I am confident on his website he can give more time. Your question was, what's the horizon? How long will it take? He may have more information about that, but let me tell you, one of the reasons why climate change is such a different environmental problem than other environmental problems. Let's think about acid rain. Acid rain was a problem where once you stop emitting things, the problem goes away pretty quickly. With climate change, the Earth's climate is like a freight train. It's got a lot of inertia. And so when you emit carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, it's going to stay around for decades or centuries. It'll continue to be absorbed into the ocean for decades or centuries, and our temperatures will rise. So if we quit emitting CO2 right now, we would experience about a degree Fahrenheit rise still in the future. So the issue is, it may be in 2030 or 2050 that acidification becomes a problem, but you can't stop it. It's not like you can just stop emitting because the climate is this freight train that's got its own inertia. And so what we do really, really matters now. And think about it, Jim Hansen testified to Congress, I think it was 1988. NASA scientist testified, could you imagine what a different state we would be in had we taken the Obama-type actions back then? I mean, think of the accumulation of carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases in the atmosphere that have happened since then. So it's a difficult question to answer, but it's a good one.
Here you are.
Is this?
Oh. Hand that down.
So it seems like you like to travel, and so do I. Any thoughts about making airplanes better, or how do we feel when we get on an airplane?
Oh man, fantastic question. This is working. It's a real problem. I know that companies are working on biofuels, especially that algae-based kind of thing for airplanes. But airplanes are energy hogs, and flying. I fly, and when I fly, it's a big contribution, it's a big personal contribution to climate change. What I would like to see, and you are seeing groups do this, is especially for work and conferences, doing remote conferencing. You can save a lot of money, you can save a lot of time, and a lot of costs. So that's one way in the professional world. And another thing that you can do is if you have to travel, you can buy offsets. Now, what are offsets? Offsets are, let's say I know I have to fly to Europe, and I know that's going to emit one ton of carbon dioxide. There are companies that you can pay, and they will do something to offset that ton. Now, it could be planting a tree. It could be installing a wind turbine. It could be cleaning up or making more efficient some coal power plant. So you can buy offsets. But I don't see biofuels being viable for aircraft for a long time. So until we're there, we're telecommuting and we're having to buy offsets or not travel.
Is anyone studying the effects of a meat-based diet on the global warming in terms of both removing rainforests from the lungs of the world as well as all the methane and stuff that's emitted by the CAFOs?
Yes, so many people are studying this. And deforestation is one of the largest single causes of emission of greenhouse gases. And then you've got the whole agro industry, which is a separate issue. I mean, they're related, but they're you can think of them as separate. So when plants grow, they grab carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere. If you have a plant which grows and then dies each year, it's a net of zero. Because it'll grab carbon dioxide when it grows, and then when it dies and it rots away, it will release it back. Now, some of it is stored through the roots in the soil. So there's some what's called sequestration of soil. But the reason why forests are so important is those trees last a long time. Okay? So if you can grow trees, they will take in a lot of carbon dioxide. Now, if you cut them down and burn them, you're releasing all the carbon dioxide, the carbon that was stored in them. So deforestation is a two-part problem. You're stopping that growth, but you're also re-releasing the stuff that had grown. I think deforestation is about a fifth of worldwide emissions. So it's about 20%. That's the number that's coming in my mind. Now, the thing about meat is a very inefficient way of making calories. And animals will, there's of course the methane from bovine, especially from cattle. That's one greenhouse gas, but then there's just the inefficiency of the animals to make the calories. It's much more efficient to eat plant-based calories than meat-based calories. It's about 9 to 1. So a cow has to eat about 9 calories to make 1 calorie. That's the rough equivalent. And then you think about farming, you've got to go through all the process of growing. There's the whole industry behind farming. So yes, the answer is many people are studying this, and it's a significant issue. There are ways we can do it better. There are ways we can be more efficient. I did some work on biofuels, corn ethanol, you've heard of that. So corn ethanol can replace gasoline, and you can grow it, and you can then refine it, and you can put it in your car. Well, it turns out that it's not that efficient. But there are other feedstocks. So I did a research project on something called switchgrass. And with switchgrass, you will grab a lot more CO2 out of the air, you'll spend less petroleum harvesting it, and you can do it on marginal lands. And you can do it in a way which increases biodiversity for the area. So there are smart things we can do in the farming industry. And I talk to a lot of farmers, and they care about land. And so I think they're a great avenue to make inroads in this area.
We give presentations like this around the stadium up in Ontario, and we've been questioned a couple times about
healing curve.
Healing curve.
Yep.
And so does that come from multiple sources, or is it just one source? And then when the 97% of all scientists, like, explain that a little bit more.
Sure, great question. So this graph comes from two groups. Scripps is in Australia, and NOAA is in the US, but there are other groups which make similar measurements. So Woods-Hole Institute makes measurements. So there's multiple people, but I'm showing you the Scripps and the NOAA. There's no scientist that I know of that doubts this. In fact, even the skeptical scientists don't doubt this. So what's this 97% deal? You've heard about that. In fact, the title of my Guardian blog is the 97% consensus. There have been multiple studies which have asked this question. What do scientists think? What percent, you know, if you get a bunch of scientists in a bar, give them a beer, how many of them would say, yeah, humans are causing climate change, and how many would say no? And so groups have looked at this different ways. Two different groups have actually gone through and read thousands of abstracts, and they've categorized them as agreeing with climate change or being contrarian or neither. One group did a poll. They did a controlled poll with a third-party polling group. They got the names of all the scientists in the American Meteorological Society, and they did this poll. Another group, by the way, that was done by a Minnesotan for her master's thesis. Another group looked at the top 200 scientists and either asked them or went to see what statements that they had said. So groups have looked at this different ways. Two different groups have actually gone through and read thousands of abstracts, and they've categorized them as agreeing with climate change or being contrarian or neither. One group did a poll. They did a controlled poll with a third-party polling group. They got the names of all the scientists in the American Meteorological Society, and they did this poll. Another group, by the way, that was done by a Minnesotan for her master's thesis. Another group looked at the top 200 scientists and either asked them or went to see what statements that they had signed on to. So I sign on letters all the time, and if I sign on to a letter saying, let's reduce carbon dioxide, they would then assume that I'm in this camp, okay. Every one of those groups has come out with the same number, 98%, 97%, one group came out 94%. All these groups that try to look at the consensus, which is, what do scientists think, have come with numbers well over 90%. That's the 97% consensus.
We have time for two more questions, if they're brief.
And I'll hang around afterwards.
Thanks. As a person living in this area, I'd like to make it so that I don't use as much coal for electricity, because I know that coal is a major thing that does that. I get all like Xcel, and I get Arcadia Power in different places saying, hey, I can give you your electricity, and it'll come only from wind. But I know that they can't really make it so that the wind electricity really gets right to my house.
Right.
Does that really make a difference in doing something like that?
Great question. So for Xcel, that program's called WindSource. And you can go in, I don't know if the other electrical companies have this, but you can actually go in and say, I want X percent of my power by wind. So my house is 100% wind allotted. And you then pay the wind price, but you don't pay the coal shipping fee, which is like $15 a month. So for me, I spend about $1 or $2 extra per month to have an 100% allotment from wind. So that's the economics. Now, does it really come from wind? No. What they do is Xcel has to, you are connected to a coal plant. So what Xcel does is they have to go out on the market and buy the equivalent in wind. That's how it works. Because if they were gonna build a line from a wind turbine to your house, that'd be very inefficient. So I recommend the wind source program. It's a great way for you to reduce your number one emission source.
So you had a chart there with corresponded to the ice drilling.
Mm-hmm.
And noticed some charts. It looked like a repeating pattern, not that one.
Yep.
This one, right there.
Yep.
Could you explain that a little bit?
Sure.
I don't understand that repeating pattern.
So, this graph on the right-hand side is now, and on the left-hand side is a little over 400,000 years ago. Now, this is not a graph of global warming. I'm not saying that cavemen were building coal plants and causing warming. What this chart is meant to show is greenhouse gases and temperature have gone together in Earth's history. So what is it that was causing these temperature changes? So from the high points to the low points is a temperature change of about 8 degrees Celsius or maybe 10, 15 degrees Fahrenheit. What was causing that if it wasn't humans? And you notice something very astute observation, it's periodic. So there is a orbital cycle. Now, if you're gonna go to a cocktail party, you wanna use this. It's called the Milankovitch cycle. It's a cycle that has to do with the tilt of the Earth and the wobble as it goes around the sun, and it changes how the sunlight hits the planet, and that cycle is what causes past temperature changes like this. These are called glaciation, interglacial periods. So this is natural, caused by orbital changes, which then cause so as the Earth warms or cools a little bit, the ocean off-gases greenhouse gases too. So there's a lot of things going on here. The point is, over the last 400,000 years, greenhouse gases and temperature have always gone together. What would make us think it's not gonna happen now? That make sense?
I have one question.
Okay.
Tell us about the isotopes of carbon, carbon 10 and carbon 14. We'll recognize what is extracted carbon and what is natural carbon.
Do you mean extracted carbon in fossil fuels or in isotopes from ice cores like this?
Both.
Okay.
We know where the carbon comes from because of the isotopes.
Yeah,
of carbon.
Great question. So carbon dioxide is going up in the atmosphere. How do we know it's from burning of fossil fuels? It's a really good question, maybe it's natural. Well, it turns out that the carbon that is going into the atmosphere is different from natural carbon because it's been buried so long and its isotopic nature has changed. So there's actually a fingerprint on that carbon. It's carbon that has been underground for millions of years. And that's what you were talking about. That's one of the reasons why we know that the Keeling curve is associated with human emissions.